Hey everyone, it's Jim
and Charles
from Valves and More, an online vintage tube store. And today in Tube Lab number 165, we're going to talk about the 6DG8, 7DG8, 6922, and 7308 tubes.
And the 6N23P Soviet equivalent.
Right, thanks for that. I always forget something. But first, caution everyone, electronics and tube amplifiers can have very high voltages present, which can be lethal. Exercise extreme caution when working around them. Always consult the professional technician when in doubt. Well, this week a whole bunch of premium vintage tubes came in, including the 6922 and 7308, the rarest of the 6DG8 types. And given how many modern amps now use at least one 6DG8, we thought it was time to take an in-depth look at this popular tube. Let's start with the data sheets. And Charles?
Okay, let's get in here and let's start first with the 6922, the 6DG8. I grabbed the other sheet. And first of all, the 6DG8 is an excellent example of a tube that found a new purpose in audio. You can see right here that it was originally intended for VHF amplification service, which of course stands for very high frequency. So this wasn't originally meant for audio, and it found a new home in it because it's a great sounding tube, and it's good at amplifying low frequencies in a very linear way as well.
And its properties for high frequencies, rugged construction, low noise, all are things that apply nicely to audio.
Exactly. And it's an interesting tube because while you often see amplification factors being called sort of a medium amplification factor being in the 20 range, maybe 20-25, and high being something 60 to 100, this sort of puts itself in the middle there. It's a bit higher than something like a 6SN7 or a 12AU7. And it's a bit lower than something like a 6SL7 or a 12AT7. And it's got an amplification factor of 33. So it's
in a useful area for a preamplifier, where if you want some higher gain or you need a circuit with higher gain in it, then this is a really good option. Mm-hmm. And it actually gives a lot of room. So most preamps don't need a gain of 33.
Yeah,
but a lot of designers like to have some room, and this gives you the room.
So it gives you the extra room, and it gives you, it allows you to use the tube in circuits that need a little bit more gain if you're running it in two stages.
Okay, now on this data sheet, they're basically saying the 6DG8, 7DG8, which is just one more volt on the filament, and that is close enough that you can actually run a 7DG8 as a 6DG8, and it'll work just fine. And I didn't even realize that there's actually a 12-volt version, the 12DG8.
Yeah, we just noticed that whenever we were taking a look at these sheets, and
That's not a common tube, though. I don't know if we've ever even seen one.
Oh, it might be interesting. Maybe there's a stockpile of them out there. I mean, 12 volts, it's not difficult to find that for a filament.
Ah, what a good idea.
So that's the 6DG8 data sheet. Let's take a look at the 7308. So what is a 7308? Well, we can see right here, the Sylvania 7308 is a special quality twin triode similar to the Sylvania Type 6922.
And what's the 6922? Well, it's basically a special quality 6DG8.
You take this exact phrasing here and swap it out, so 6922 is similar to the 6DG8 type. That's pretty much what it is. So it's just a higher quality version. It's probably selected. It's meant for lower noise, longer life, and higher reliability.
And in this particular version, is this the one that's got the 10,000 hour rated filament?
Yes. So actually this data sheet was almost copied word for word from the original Philips data sheet, which is a little bit weird because the Philips data sheets format everything quite a bit differently. So we actually found some errors in this, which is kind of interesting because they did that copying.
And that's a good point to bring up, that even if you're designing around, let's say you've got a couple of sleeves of Sylvania 7308s and you're designing the ultimate preamp for your system, The smart thing to do would be to go back to the original inventor of the 6DG8 and 7308 and 6922.
Which, of course, is Philips.
Yeah.
They would have the best data sheet. And Philips has amazing data sheets. They pack so much information on them.
Almost too much.
They'll put operating points for every possible use for the tube. They give you reliability data over its lifespan, how it was tested. I mean, I think the 7308 on the original data sheet, they were testing it with 500G acceleration impacts and testing to make sure that it was still operating within parameters at 10,000 hours, which is just absolutely incredible.
And that tells you that most likely the biggest buyer of these higher spec tubes were militaries.
Mm-hmm. So there are a few other differences between the 7308 and a standard 6DG8 type. I'm not going to go too much into the details here, but it has generally lower capacitances overall, which is really good. And it has a slightly lower plate dissipation of 1.65 watts compared to 1.8 per plate on the original. But given that this is actually mainly used as a voltage amplification tube, that's just fine. They probably did that for reliability purposes.
And that may have gotten the higher specs that they were looking for as well.
Most likely. It also actually uses a little bit less heater current, just a tiny bit. It's almost not even worth mentioning. I think it's 30 milliamps or something like
that. Yeah, it's at 10%, which is probably within what you would call a normal spec variance. But anyways, this is getting kind of boring, Charles. How about we take a look at some of the tubes?
Yeah, let's take a look at them. So we've got them arrayed out here, and we're going to start over here. And what this is actually a Philips 6DG8 type. And Philips, being the one that invented the tube, made some of the best ones out there. And you're going to see that all the ones that are following this have a very, very similar plate structure. Everybody did this very similarly.
And they got a very rigid kind of a frame.
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple of variations even within the Philips lineup of tubes.
And this is commonly referred to as the A-frame type. You can see the two different legs that are coming up here and this massive getter on the top.
Now the problem is the Philips tubes are getting rare. And
just like all the great Philips tubes.
Just like all of them. But the good news is that Sylvania made some wonderful 6DG8 types. And in fact, later on, Philips actually bought up Sylvania, and all of the global production was basically coming out of the Sylvania plant under the Philips name.
So let's take a look at that. Here we have a Sylvania standard 6DG8 type, and you can see the plate structure again is very similar. All these tubes have almost the exact same plate structure on them. But this one, of course, is labeled Philips ECG. So this was after Philips purchased Sylvania. They started manufacturing these tubes, and they commonly have these sort of off blue, teal, or green labels on them. And they're easy to recognize that way. So that's a standard 6DG8, and I believe actually we've got it. Yeah, you can see it's maybe.
I think it's
etched
got
in the glass right there.
I think it has a JAN on it, doesn't it? So it's Joint Army Navy?
Yep.
Yeah.
Next up, we have something that looks almost identical, but not quite. So different shade of blue. We've got another Philips tube, and this is the 6922. And again, they look very similar. They're going to operate the exact same in a circuit, although the 6922, of course, is the better rated version. It's probably going to be longer lived and less chance of noise.
And these were also made at the Sylvania USA plant, probably the Emporium plant.
Mm-hmm. And finally, we have a 7308, and this one is actually labeled Sylvania. It has that same etched code on here, 7308. And we were lucky enough to find, I think, three sleeves of these, all from the same production batch, all the same dates, and all testing absolutely beautifully.
Very close matches, which is a good sign, because a lot of the time now, even when we find new old stock tubes, they've been picked over.
Yeah.
And we end up with essentially the bottom of the barrel. And that's very, very common with virtually any tube you buy these days. It's a vintage tube. So we've got to be very careful. We do, I mean, testing is a big part of what we do and matching, and then listening. And we just rejoice whenever we find batches of tubes, particularly new old stock tubes, that have not been picked over, that are actually the original tubes in the original sleeves.
It's obvious right away when we test them.
Yeah.
Yeah. They come in tight, they come in close, and failures are rare. So that is the 7308. And if you're looking for a 6DJ8 type, that's about the best that you can get. But all of these are going to be great tubes. And lastly, we have the Soviet equivalent. So the Soviets, of course, made an equivalent to most major Western tube types. I mean, they were using them in similar equipment. In some cases, especially around World War II, they were using them in the same equipment that was being given to them using, I think it was Lend-Lease at the time.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, there was all kinds of complicated names for essentially...
war aid.
Yeah. War aid. We're going to make these a gift, but because Congress won't vote for it, we're going to actually lend them, even though everybody knows we're never going to get paid for it.
Yeah. So this is another version of the 6DJ8. It isn't officially an equivalent to, but it is essentially the same in every way that matters, and it will actually work in the same circuits just fine. This one was made by Voskhod, and they're commonly called Voskhod rockets, because I don't know if we actually can see the logo on this one. They tend to fade over time, but they actually have nice little rocket logos whenever you can see them. So this is another example of a great 6DJ8 that you could put in your system.
Yeah, and we even got some, we didn't bring one out, but we've got Toshiba 7DJ8s that are quite well respected.
Mm-hmm.
And they will work absolutely perfectly fine. What will end up happening, of course, is that the filament current will shift slightly.
And since the voltage is a little bit lower than the tube is expected, the current is going to be a little bit higher.
Yeah.
But given that these are low current voltage amplifying tubes to begin with, it shouldn't stress any circuit out there.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks for going through all of this. That's really quite interesting that Philips and Sylvania ended up with very similar tubes with the specs improving over the years. And I think the same thing happened with the 12AX7s. We ended up with a low noise version, and then everybody just ended up renaming their 12AX7s. Okay, well, I think we should take a look and see what came in, because you got a lot of really nice stuff in this week.
Okay, let's get these out of the way here and not drop them.
Okay, well, you've got some fun things. Let's get
Hold on. Let's start with this first.
Well, I was going to
look
stack
at the size difference.
Going to stack them up.
So this is an example of the sleeves that we got of the 7308s. And, of course, as you can tell, they're white boxed military tubes.
And it's typical of this period of the later production out of Sylvania with the Philips name. Brand name on it. They were all made in the early 1980s.
Mm-hmm. You can see the date right there. And isn't this funny? I don't think we've ever seen a sleeve this large before. Look at the size of this thing. This is a standard 9-pin box, and these, of course, are for 6AS7s.
But there's a bigger story to it. They're not actually 6AS7s, are they? Well, they are, in a way.
Let me get one of these out here so you can take a look. There we go. Exact same sort of labeling. Actually, funny enough, same date.
Yeah. So what's the tube that's inside there?
Well, let's get that out of the way. And wait a second. That's not a 6AS7. That is a 6080. And why would it be labeled that way?
Well, what happened is the Pentagon would end up with a piece of equipment that had a call replacement order for tubes that was for the older version, the 6AS7. But of course, Sylvania at this point was only making the modern version, the 6080. So the solution, of course, and the tubes, of course, are totally compatible. You can put a 6080 into a 6AS7 circuit and it'll work perfectly. They're basically the same tube. Maybe a little higher spec as we get a little later into the production period of the 6080s.
And more compact, too.
And more compact. So all they did was to meet the military order that came in is just to label them to meet the order.
And that was really common with military orders. The military would say, we need six AS-7s. And Sylvania would say, well, I don't have six AS-7s, but I've got 6080s. So here's some six AS-7s.
We saw actually the same thing with Sylvania and six SN-7s.
Yep.
We've got beautiful 12 SN-7 GTs that are in fact GTBs, mm-hmm. but they're labeled GTs. But you can tell right away that they're not a GT.
Exactly. So we actually managed to find a couple of these gigantic sleeves of these tubes. And we had a few of this type before. I think they're technically under the 6080WC in the store. And they've been popular with crack owners. So it's nice finding some more of them like this. They tested absolutely beautifully, all consistent, close to each other, close match sections. So these would be great tubes for crack amps or similar OTL amps.
And we're testing them for emissions because they're typically being used as an output tube. So mm-hmm. we really aren't concerned about the transconductance at this point. What we want to know is what the idle emissions are.
Especially whenever they only have an amplification factor of 2.
Right. Okay.
So we managed to get some of those in, and we found some other really interesting tubes here. Let's get them out. This is something else that we see very rarely, and these are the I believe it's the 6N14P, or is it 6P14N? I don't remember
six,
exactly.
6P14, well, P, yeah, in Cyrillic it's 6N14N-EB, and in English that translates to the 6P14P-EV. Is that confusing or what? But what they really are is the higher spec EL84,
which Soviet is equivalent.
Soviet equivalent, which is in fact the equivalent to the 7308. Is that the number?
No. Well, the 7308 is the 6DJ.
Oh no, I screwed it up. Do you remember what the number is?
Not off the top of my head.
Well, I'm going to bring it up in the store while you're talking here.
Yeah, it shows you how prepared we were for this. But this is basically the best version of an EL84 that the Soviets ever made. And there's only a couple of different variations of them, and these are the later one. We actually have a small number of the earlier ones, but unfortunately not enough to make up a matched quad. We've had some requests for these, and we were able to find some from one of our great suppliers in Eastern Europe. So we've got some excellent matched quads in the store. We've tried to date match them as well as we can. These ones are all from 82 and 81, and they're all testing right at new old stock. So that's absolutely fantastic.
Okay, I looked it up. It's a 7189.
There we go. It starts with a 7, so yeah.
Yeah.
So these are in the store now if you're interested in them. There's lots of amps that use EL84s, and this is going to be one of the best ones that you can get for them.
And best of all, compared to what the Western 7189 would cost you, these are actually really quite affordable. So.
Oh, and you know, available still.
Yeah. Okay, well, if you stay till the very end, here's some discount codes to help you out. And remember, we can get to almost everybody around the world with flat rate $20 shipping. But if your order is $150 or more after discount, the shipping is on us, folks. And of course, there's some secret code that's easy to figure out, and people have been getting it and costing us some serious money. In fact, last week we got slammed. Unbelievable. Usually we see a little bit of a boost in orders for Christmas, but wow, it was huge. Thank goodness things have slowed down and we got caught up. Stay safe, everyone. This is Jim
and Charles
signing off. Cheers, everyone.